It's Medicosis Perfectionados, where medicine makes perfect sense. We continue our series called Labs. In previous videos, we have talked about choline esterase, the true one and the pseudo one, and the anti-acetylcholine receptor antibodies seen in myasthenia gravis. Today, it's time for beta 2 microglobulin. It's a shame that most doctors are doofuses when it comes to this topic. It's an amazing topic. Let's go back to square one. What are we talking about here? We're talking about your leukocytes, which are your white blood cells. Where do these white blood cells come from? Well, it depends. Most of them come from myeloid stem cells, which came from pluripotent stem cells in the bone marrow. We call them hematopoietic stem cells, and they are CD34 positive. That's their ID. They give you two things, myeloid and lymphoid stem cells. The myeloid will give you everything except lymphocytes. Myeloid, give me red blood cells, give me granulocytes, which include BEN, basophils, eosinophils, neutrophils. They have granules in them. Neutrophils have neutral granules, basophils have basophilic granules, eosinophils have, guess what, eosinophilic granules. And then give me monocytes, which will become histiocytes, macrophages down the road, and megakaryoblasts to give me some platelets. Then the next one is the lymphoid. So we have myeloid and lymphoid. Lymphoid, give me lymphocytes, B lymphocytes and T lymphocytes, and some street fighters known as natural killer cells. B lymphocytes are known to mature and grow up and stop being so naive, if you know what I'm saying, and then they mature. They become plasma cells. Plasma cells secrete antibodies, and you have five of them: IgM, IgA, IgG, IgE, and IgD. Here is a quick note. Can we boost the red blood cell count? Yeah, give me EPO, erythropoietin. Can we boost the platelet count? Yeah, give me TPO, thrombopoietin. Can we boost the granulocytes? Sure, give me GCSF, granulocyte colony stimulating factor. How about boosting the monocytes? Yeah, MCSF, monocyte colony stimulating factor. Can we boost both? Yeah, collectively called GMCSF, granulocyte monocyte colony stimulating factors. Okay, today's topic has to do with white blood cells or leukocytes. Leuko means white, cytes means cells, and they are five: neutrophils, basophils, eosinophils. These are the granulocytes. Monocytes and lymphocytes are the non-granulocytes. Where do we find beta 2 microglobulin? You find it here on white blood cells. White blood cells are your military members. They are your defense system. And you have the granulocytes. You have BEN, basophils, eosinophils, neutrophils. Then the non-granulocytes, monocytes, and lymphocytes. Get some blood from a patient's vein. Put the blood in a stinking test tube. Leave the tube alone to stand alone. And then wait some time. You'll find plasma will go to the top. Red blood cells to the bottom. This is called sedimentation. And in between, there is a very, very, very thin, teeny tiny layer called the buffy coat, which has the white blood cells and the platelets. By the way, sometimes the buffy coat appears green in color. Do you know why? If you know the answer, let me know in the comment section. In my rheumatology playlist, we have talked about the human leukocytic antigens in detail. Here is what you need to know in a nutshell. They are called human, therefore what? You find them only in humans. How about monkeys? No, they are actually different in monkeys. Monkeys have monkey leukocyte antigens. Oh, so you're trying to say that human leukocytic antigens are different from monkey leukocytic antigens and from cockroaches' leukocytic antigen? That's exactly the point. Your antigens are different from other species. So that's the word human. Antigens, what does that mean? They are antigens. They will generate antibodies against them. Oh! This is where the word antigen come from, a generator of antibodies. Leukocytic, because they are found on your leukocytes or your white blood cells. Human leukocytic antigens are part of the MHC, major histocompatibility complex. Why did we call it complex? Because it's more than one protein. Why do we call it major? Because we have minors and we don't care about them right now. Histocompatibility, they assure that they are compatible with tissues. That's why if you will undergo kidney transplant, the doctor will match your blood, that's number one, and will match your MHC between the donor and the recipient. Oh, to make sure that the new kidney tissue will be compatible with your own body. Otherwise, the MHC is gonna beat the living crap out of your new kidney. We have three classes of MHC. MHC class 1, class 2, and guess what? Class 3. We don't care about class 3. Let's focus on 1 and 2. Class 1 includes HLA, A, B, C. Yeah, these are the first three letters in the alphabet. give them to class one. How about class two? Since we are done with ABC, what's the next letter? D. Good job, Sally. And then we have subtypes of the D. So we start with the same letter as the ECG. We start with the P wave and then the Q wave, the R wave, same thing. DP, DQ, DR. And then the DR is subdivided into DR2, DR3. These people have, like, they need to get a life. MHC class 1 will interact with CD8. MHC class 2 will interact with CD4 T cells. The mnemonic is you multiply both together, the product has to always be 8. Here is the structure of MHC class 1. It looks like this. It has an alpha 1 component, an alpha 2 component, an alpha 3 component, and today's topic, beta 2 microglobulin. Micro, look at it. It's so tiny, it's unbelievable. And you will find this MHC class 1 standing on top of the antigen presenting cell, which include dendritic cells, macrophages, and B lymphocytes. Please remember the mnemonic, the product has to equal 8. I've told you that this is MHC class 1, therefore it has to interact with CD8, so that 8 times 1 equals 8. What is CD8 called? T cytotoxic cell, that's a T lymphocyte, therefore it has a T cell receptor. Cool, it will interact with MHC1. Why bother? Because this is antigen presenting the cell, presenting the antigen on a plate of silver. To the glorious CD8 T lymphocyte. It's cytotoxic. Now it will stop being so naive and grow the hell up. And when the CD8 grows up, it's cytotoxic. It will be the living crap of virus-infected cells and cancer cells. What are the functions of white blood cells in general? Inflammation, infection, immunity. If you have inflammation, you can thank your white blood cells. They are trying to protect you against bacteria. Same with infection. Immunity. If your body recognized a foreign antigen, baby, it's on. The war is on. Now, please consider me as an idiot for 2 seconds and answer my 2 questions. If we call it human leukocytic antigen, where do you think it's located? On the leukocytes? No, duh. Great. My second question is, here is my second question. In what conditions will the level of beta 2 microglobulin increase in your blood? Any condition that has leukocytosis? Genius. Can you give me examples? Inflammation, infection, immunological, the famous 3 I's, and malignancy. Oh, so you think beta 2 microglobulin level in the blood will be high in HIV? Yeah, it's an infection. How about CMV? Sure, it's an infection. So if beta 2 microglobulin will increase in cases of infection, would you please consider it as an acute phase reactant, so to speak? Yeah, why not? Next, do you think beta 2 microglobulin level will increase in case of lymphoma? Yeah, it's a malignancy. How about leukemia? It's a malignancy. Multiple myeloma, a stinking malignancy. Not only are they are malignancies of white blood cells. And this is called what? Human leukocytic antigens. So if the level of beta 2 microglobulin is high in cases of malignancies, would you please consider it to be a tumor marker, roughly speaking? Sure. How about renal transplant rejection? Do you think beta 2 microglobulin will go up? Yeah, because this is an immunological phenomenon. Now this part is one of the most amazing and astonishing areas in medicine. And this will require you to do without your stupidity for a moment. After that, you can reclaim your stupidity back, just as the proximal convoluted tubule reclaimed its bicarbonate back. There you go. Remember the beta 2 microglobulin? Yeah. If it's called globulin, do you think it's fat, carbohydrate, or protein? Well, anything that ends in IN is most of the time protein, so it's a protein. And I know that proteins in the plasma are either albumin or globulin, therefore it's a protein. Sure, it's a protein. Proteins and peptides in general, do you think they are water-soluble or lipid-soluble? They are water-soluble. Therefore what? The kidney is gonna excrete them. Genius. That's why your water-soluble vitamins are easily excreted. Oh yeah, because they are water-soluble. No kidding. Medicine makes so much sense once you understand what the flip you're talking about. Beta 2 microglobulin, a protein, will be filtered in the glomerulus. Yes. Therefore, the normal function of the glomerulus is to excrete beta 2 microglobulin. Do you agree? Yeah. But look here in the tubule. Now, what's gonna happen is reabsorption of beta 2 microglobulin from the filtrate, aka the urine, into the blood. This is called reabsorption. So we are excreted by the glomerulus, but reabsorbed by the tibule. Agree? Yeah. Okay, medicosis, this is astonishing, but why do I care? Let me tell you why. Imagine that I were your professor. I was running around swinging my gluteus maximus into the lecture hall. And then I ask you, hey student, please stand up. Okay, professor. What's your name, son? My name is Cody. Okay, Cody, please tell me, how can you differentiate between a glomerular disease and a tubular disease?
I can order a renal biopsy.
Oh, give me a break. Will you start by a renal biopsy? Don't you think, Cody, that this is a little bit invasive?
Oh, yeah, I don't know what to do.
Well, if nothing else, you can try urine cast. A cast is the shape of the tubule. If you find casts in the urine, it means it came from a tubule that's a tubular disease. No cast, it's probably a glomerular disease. That's one. You want another one? You can measure the level of beta 2 microglobulin in the urine and in the blood. I don't get it. Let me explain, Cody. This beta 2 microglobulin was supposed to be excreted in the glomerulus and reabsorbed by the tubules. Agreed?
Agreed.
Now imagine that you have glomerular disease. Do you think your glomerulus will be able to excrete beta 2 microglobulin into the urine? No. Therefore what? Two things will happen. You will have increased beta 2 microglobulin in the blood because no one excreted it. Yeah, it will be retained in your blood. Perfect. Also, by the same token, you will have decreased level of beta 2 microglobulin in the urine. Agree?
Yeah.
Now here is the magic part, Cody. Look at tubular disease. Now in case of tubular disease, your tubule will not be able to reabsorb beta 2 microglobulin. Therefore what? If you cannot reabsorb, beta 2 microglobulin will remain in the urine. It will stay in the filtrate until you pee it out. Therefore it will increase in the urine. Yes. And by the same token, decrease in the blood. Sure, and that's how you can differentiate between glomerular disease and tubular disease. Isn't that amazing? And since I have bipolar 1 disorder, I deserve a round of applause. Shut up. Beta 2 microglobulin level in the blood, in the urine, in the CSF. What's the normal value of beta 2 microglobulin in the blood?
1.1 to 2.4.
So it's like double milligrams per liter. Urine, 0 to 160 micrograms per liter. And then CSF, 0 to 2.4 milligrams per liter. Okay, what are the conditions that will lead to increase beta 2 microglobulin in the blood? Let's go. HIV,
why? It's an infection. CMV, why? It's an infection.
Leukemia, why? Malignancy. Lymphoma, malignancy. Myeloma, malignancy. Kidney transplant rejection, immunological. Glomerular disease, because the normal function of the glomerulus was to excrete beta 2 microglobulin. Now the glomerulus is toast. No longer able to excrete, the beta 2 microglobulin will be retained in the blood because no one will excrete it, which will increase the blood level of beta 2 microglobulin. Cool. What will decrease the blood level of beta 2 microglobulin? Tubular disease, because the tubules now cannot reabsorb the beta 2 microglobulin. They will be left to fall in the urine. Left to fall in the urine, therefore, tubular disease will have increased beta 2 microglobulin in the urine. Yeah. Also HIV and CMV. Why? They are infections. And if the level of beta 2 microglobulin is high in your plasma, it will be high in the urine. Because where do you think we get the urine from? From your blood. Where do you think you get your sweat from? From your blood. Where do you get your saliva from? From your blood. How about your precious crocodile tears? From the blood. If it's high in the blood, it will be high in the urine. Same thing with leukemia, lymphoma, and myeloma, provided that your glomerulus is normal. But if your glomerulus is screwed, you will have a low level of beta 2 microglobulin in the urine. Heavy metals can trash your kidney. Drugs can shock your kidney. Therefore, the kidney is struggling. And these two things will damage the tubules, particularly. Remember Fanconi syndrome? Yeah, it was a proximal tubular defect, usually caused by heavy metal poisoning, drug poisoning, etc., etc., and so on and so forth. Measure beta 2 microglobulin in my CSF. If it's high, it's probably the neoplasm has reached the brain. We consider beta 2 microglobulin to be an acute phase reactant, so to speak, and a tumor marker, roughly speaking. If you want to learn more about the kidney, check out my electrolytes course, the best on the planet. It will help you master hypernatremia, hyponatremia, hyperkalemia, hypokalemia, hypercalcemia, hypocalcemia, etc. You'll also learn how these electrolyte changes can affect your ECG. Go to medicosisperfectionalis.com and you can download it right now. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe, hit the bell, and click on the join button. You can support me here or here. Go to my website to download my premium courses today. Thank you so much for watching. As always, be safe, stay happy, and study hard. This is Medicosis Perfectionalis, where medicine makes perfect sense.